बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम। अस्सलाम वालेकुम स्टूडेंट्स, टुडे वी आर स्टार्टिंग अवर फर्स्ट ऑनलाइन लेक्चर फॉर क्लास 9th फिजिक्स विच वी स्टार्ट्स फ्रॉम चैप्टर नंबर 4 विच नेम्ड एज टर्निंग इफेक्ट्स ऑफ फोर्सेस। नाउ फ्रॉम टॉपिक 4.1 लाइक एंड अनलाइक पैरेलल फोर्सेस। In this topic, we will discuss about like parallel forces and unlike parallel forces. As you see from the name of the topic, like parallel forces are something same to each other, unlike having different to each other. Parallel forces are the forces that never meet each other at any point or intersect each other at any point. Figure 4.3 illustrates you a bag in which we put many apples. The weights of the apples is acting downward direction because it is a vector quantity and always act in the downward direction. These all weights, the forces which we represent, these weights are parallel to each other because these are never meet each other at any point. Such forces are called parallel forces, and if these forces have the same direction to each other, then we are called like parallel forces. And now see picture A, in which a apple is hanging by a string. In this picture, the weight of the apple is acting downward direction, while the tension in the string, which we know that the tension is a force, act opposite to the weight of the body in a string, is acting upward direction. These two forces are also parallel to each other, but the direction is opposite, so these are called unlike parallel forces. So for the definition of like parallel forces, are the forces that are parallel to each other and have the same direction. And the unlike parallel forces are the forces which are parallel to each other but not have the same direction. As you see in the figure B, the two forces F1 and F2 are acting on a rod. F1 is acting on one corner in the upward direction, F2 is acting on the other corner but in backward direction. So that's why these two are acting in opposite direction, so we call these two forces unlike parallel forces. Now move to topic 4.2, addition of forces. Force is a vector quantity, it has both magnitude and direction. Therefore, forces are not added by ordinary arithmetic rules. When forces are added, we get a resultant force. A resultant force is a single force that has the same effect as the combined effect of all the forces to be added. Students, we cannot add forces like scalar quantities because scalar quantities have only magnitude only, and in case of vector quantities, because force is a vector quantity, vectors have magnitude as well as direction, so we cannot add vector quantities like scalars. To add the vector quantities, we used a rule which is called head to tail rule. According to head to tail rule, we draw the vectors in such a direction that the first vector is drawn, the second vector's tail, with tail is called its starting point, and the arrowhead is called head of the vector, which represents the direction. The second vector's tail must be joining to the head of first vector, then the resultant vector is drawn, which the resultant vector's tail is joining with the first vector tail and its head is joining to the last vector's head. Figure 4.5 shows a graphical method of vector addition. First select a suitable scale, then draw the vectors of all the forces according to the scale, such as vectors A and B. Take any one of the vectors as first vector. For example, vector A we take as first vector, then draw next vector B such that its tail coincides with the head of the first vector A, as we discussed earlier. Similarly, draw the next vector for the third force, if any. We add any number of vectors according to head to tail rule with its tail coinciding with the head of the previous vector and so on. Now draw a vector R. R is represented the resultant vector, such that its tail is at the tail of vector A, as we discussed earlier, that the resultant vector's tail must be joining to the first vector tail and its head is joining the lost vector's head, while its head is at the head of vector B, which is lost vector. As shown in figure 4.5, vector R represent the resultant force completely in magnitude and direction. In the side box, it should be noted that head to tail rule can be used to add any number of forces. The vector representing resultant force gives the magnitude and direction of the resultant forces. Now we'll discuss example 4.1. In this example, we have find the resultant of three forces. One force is 12 newton along x-axis. We represent this force with F1. Other force is 8 newton making an angle of 45 degree with x-axis. We represent this force with F2, and 8 newton along y-axis. This is representing by F3, as you see in the next page. Now choose a suitable scale, because why we choose a scale? Due to this reason, that the newtons are not representing on your ruler scale. That's why these measurements on the ruler scale is in centimeters or millimeters. So we convert newtons into centimeter, as in this example we have chosen a scale that 1 centimeter equals to 2 newton, means that force F1 is equals to 12 newton, then it is representing by a line of 6 centimeter. F2 is representing by 8 newton, which is representing by a line of 4 centimeter on the scale. F3 is also representing by 4 centimeter on the scale. We draw these two vectors in such a way that the direction of first vector, which is along x-axis F1, as you see in the figure 4.6, then F2 is along 45 degree with x-axis. F2 is drawn in such a way that its tail coincides with the head of vector A. Then we draw the vector force F3, which tail is coinciding with vector B. Now we draw a resultant vector, and must we have the tail of the resultant vector joining the vector A, and its head must be joining to vector CD. Then it is called resultant vector. Now from topic 4.3, resolution of forces, the process of splitting of vectors into their component forces is called resolution of forces. Means a force is split up to its two components. One component is along x-axis, which is called horizontal component. Other component is along y-axis, which is called vertical component of the force. The component which is along x-axis is shown with Fx, means horizontal component of the force, and the component which is along y-axis is represented by Fy, means vertical components of a force. The definition is as splitting up of a force into two mutually perpendicular components. Perpendicular components, the two components which have an angle of 90 degree between them, is called the resolution of that forces. Consider a force F representing by line OA making an angle theta with x-axis, as shown in figure 4.7. Draw a perpendicular AB on x-axis from A according to head to tail rule. OA is the resultant of vectors representing by OB and BA. As you see in the figure, that OA is represented by vector F, force F. OB is represented by FX, is horizontal component, and BA is represented by FY, its vertical component. Then according to head to tail rule, OA is equals to OB plus B into A. OA is representing by F, OB is representing by FX, and BA is representing by FY. Now put these values into this equation 4.1, and we get equation 4.2, which is F is equals to FX plus FY. Now we have to find the magnitude of these two components of a force, which are Fx and Fy. We derive our equations to find out the magnitude of these components. For this, we have to find out the trigonometric ratios between this triangle OA and B. The first trigonometric ratios, which is cos theta. Cos theta, as we know, that cos theta is equals to base divided by hypotenuse, and in this figure we have base fx and hypotenuse f. So fx divided by f is equals to cos theta. Here we have to find the magnitude of fx, so we multiply f on the other side of the equation. So fx is equals to f cos theta is equation 4.3. Now we discuss the other trigonometric ratio, which is sine theta. As we know that sine theta is equals to perpendicular divided by hypotenuse, so that's why perpendicular is representing by fy and hypotenuse is representing by again f. We have to find the